Welcome. Let's open the word of the Lord together. Luke chapter 16 is where we will begin our time together. Luke chapter 16. Now, before we read the holy word of the Lord, let's prepare our heart. Let's prepare our mind. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you, God, that your word is flawless, perfect, breathed out by you. It is the only flawless anything that we have. And so we're grateful, Father, that you have preserved your word, passed it down from generation to generation for us in this moment to open and know that what we are about to read is holy. Every word is holy. However, what we do understand is that we are inadequate, we are imperfect, and so we ask for the Holy Spirit to give us the discernment that we need to interpret your word correctly, to read it and understand and be able to apply what it says from each line. Now, the beauty is, God, that you told us that you left us a comforter, the Holy Spirit, the very third member of the triune God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Father who spoke through the prophets, the Son who walked the earth and made a way for our redemption, and the Holy Spirit, the one who is with us now, living within us. The beauty of that is that wherever we are, right this moment, that the very presence of the Holy God is with us, giving us each individual discernment. However, we need to come to the same conclusion because it is written by one author. And the conclusion is that the word is perfect and it is all that we need for life and godliness. Help us now, Holy Spirit, to look into the word, discern it rightly, and apply it effectively. We ask this in Jesus' name, and wherever you are, you can agree by saying amen and amen. Well, let's open the word of the Lord to Luke 16. Before we read verse 1, I want to help you understand what we're about to get into. Dr. Stanley Tousset gave a lecture series on what he called problem parables. He did this much later in his life, and he said it took his life to be able to fully grasp the depth of some of these parables. Problem parables, meaning parables that the Lord spoke that might be misunderstood when they are first read at first glance. What's interesting is in Luke 16, there are two parables that made it into Dr. Tousset's problem parables, because both the beginning, what we have here is the parable of the dishonest manager, and what we see at the end with this rich man and Lazarus, two back-to-back stories that are very complex. And if not understood correctly, we could get the wrong meaning from it. So let's really pay attention into the holy text to make sure that we can take these, what could be misunderstood teachings of Jesus, and apply them correctly. Let's dig in. Verse 1. He also said to the disciples, "There was a rich man who had a manager, and charges were brought to him that this man was wasting his possessions. And he called him and said to him, 'What is this that I hear about you? Turn in the account of your management, for you can no longer be manager.' And the manager said to himself, 'What shall I do since my master is taking the management away from me? I am not strong enough to dig. I am ashamed to beg. I have decided what to do, so that when I am removed from management, people may receive me into their houses. So summoning his master's debtors one by one, he said to the first, "How much do you owe my master?" And he said, 100 measures of oil. He said to him, "Take your bill and sit down quickly and write 50. Then he said to another, "And how much do you owe?" He said, 100 measures of wheat. He said to him, "Take your bill and write 80. Now, let's just pause for a minute and grab our bearings about this. We have a very wealthy landowner. Clearly, he has a sharecropper set up where those farmers can use his different sects of land for different purposes, and they'll owe him partial of the crop. And then he also has this manager. Somehow the wealthy man finds out that the person managing his land has not been honest, has not been doing a good job, and so he is relieving him of his duties, saying, "You need to settle the books and then you are finished." What we find is the story mostly about this manager who is being relieved because he is inadequate. He has not done a good job at managing. He's been dishonest. But what we see here is that he very clearly is trying to ensure that after he ends his employment with this particular person who owns all this property, he needs to ensure his future. Where is he going from here? He needs to think ahead. And you see that when he says, I can't dig. I am too proud to beg. I need to ensure where I'm going. What's going to happen after? And that's where we get down to verse 6. He gathers these people together and he says, "How much do you owe the master?" And the first person says, 100 measures of oil. Now, a measure is 8 3/4 gallons, which means that this is over 900 gallons of olive oil. 900 gallons of olive oil. An immense amount of money is owed to this wealthy landowner, and he just cuts it in half and says, "Hurry up and write this down." Do you notice that in verse 6 it says, "Sit down quickly and write 50. We know this in our common day, that someone who is pushing us to be quickly, normally these things are not honest dealings. These are scams when it's, you know, this has to be done immediately and quickly. Don't think about it, just sign your name. This is a quick offer. However, if you're the one that owes over 900 gallons of olive oil, which the cost of that is so exuberant, and you owe that to the landowner, and someone comes along and says, "Here, quickly write down that you only owe 50%, you would sign that quickly. Then he goes to the next person in verse 7. He says, "How much do you owe?" He said, 100 measures of wheat. That's about 1,000 bushels of wheat that he owes. Now, remember, this has to be gathered by hand. This could take years and years and years to gather that many bushels of wheat to give. And so he gives him a large discount. Why is he giving discounts to these different individuals? And we have two examples, but the idea in the parable is that he's bringing all the people that owe the master money, and he's giving them all a discount so that they owe him a favor. He is being shrewd about this. He's thinking forward, and he's saying, "I am going to need a favor because my employment for the master has come to an end. And I'm trying to ensure my future so that when I am finally removed from my master's keeping, I no longer have control of the books, I no longer have an income, I no longer can live at my master's house, I no longer have any income to take care of my personal needs, I can go to the one who I cut a bargain for and say, 'Remember how I was good to you? Will you be good to me?'" He's shrewd. Now let's go to verse 8, because it says, "The master commended the dishonest manager for his shrewdness. For the sons of this world are more shrewd in dealing with their own generation than the sons of light. Let's pause, because that is easily misinterpreted. The master commends the dishonest manager for his shrewdness. So let's make sure that we understand the word shrewdness, to make sure that we understand what the master is commending, the dishonest manager. Clearly, he's not commending him that he cost him so much of his fortune. He cut one bill right in half. Of course, the master is not happy that he lost so much profit because of a dishonest manager. He's commending him about his shrewdness. And that word shrewd in the Greek is phronimos. Phronimos. And the meaning is prudent, thoughtful, and wise. So it has a different meaning than what we might think shrewd means. We have a very negative meaning to the word shrewd. Conniving is what we also have listed under shrewd. But in the Greek, it was, he was prudent, he was thoughtful, he was very wise, even though he did it in a dishonest way. So the master is not commending the dishonesty. He's commending that was pretty clever, because you just ensured that you have another place to live. That was very clever of you to take care of yourself. Now, it's not the right way, but it was very clever to do that. Now, he was thinking ahead. Let's hold that idea about thinking ahead, preparing oneself, because when we look back at verse 8, it says, the sons of this world are more shrewd, remember, they're more prudent and thoughtful and wise in their dealings with their own generation than the sons of light. So those that are not believers in Jesus Christ are diligently working, and they're working very hard. However, the sons of light, the Christians, that would be us, we're not as thoughtful and wise and prudent. We're not thinking ahead. Now, we're going to use this towards the kingdom of God, not the ways of wickedness. That's what the dishonest manager did. He was just taking care of himself. We're supposed to look at this towards our heavenly dwelling. Are we thinking ahead towards our heavenly dwelling? Are we investing? Are we being thoughtful about our eternal dwelling? Are we investing in our eternal dwelling? That's what this means. So let's take a look at Matthew chapter 6, verse 19. It says, do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy, where thieves break in and steal, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroy, where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So let's think, are we being shrewd, according to the Greek, phronimos? Are we being wise about our investments here on earth? Are they investments in things that are eternal? Now, let's go back to Luke 16. Let's go to verse 9. Jesus continues, and I tell you, make friends for yourselves by means of unrighteous wealth, so that when it fails, they may receive you into the eternal dwellings. Again, that is a very confusing sentence, so let's break it apart and make sure we understand what it means. Verse 9, unrighteous wealth. What is that? That's finances here on earth. It's unrighteous. It's not a heavenly wealth. It's not something that we inherit that will be a forever wealth. It is something that's here. It's unrighteous. It's not holy. It's something we're entrusted with, and it's gained by the effort that we put in. We work and we receive an unrighteous. It's not a holy wealth. It's not a something that you can take with you. It's something that is here. That's why it says, take by means of unrighteous wealth, so that when it fails. unrighteous wealth, simply the finances that we're entrusted with on earth, will not purchase your eternity into heaven. It will fail. When this life is over for you and I both understand we cannot take our earthly wealth with us. Nothing that we earn here can we take there. So what he says is, let's go back and look at verse 9. I tell you, make friends for yourself by means of unrighteous wealth with our finances, so that when it fails, when this life is over, they may receive you into the eternal dwelling. What this is telling us is invest in the things of God so that when this life is over, we are welcomed into the presence of God. You can't buy your way into heaven. That's not at all what this is saying. But you can invest into the things of God. I'll show you what that looks like, because that's kind of a tricky thing. You can't purchase heaven. You can't make a large donation to the house of God and somehow get a tax receipt that says this will now purchase your mansion in heaven. However, you can invest in the things of God and it counts to your credit. Let me show you what that looks like. Philippians chapter 4, verse 15 is written by the Apostle Paul, and he's under house arrest. And he writes to the Philippians and he says, "And you, Philippians, yourselves know that in the beginning of the gospel, when I left Macedonia, no church entered into partnership with me in giving and receiving except you only. Even in Thessalonica, you sent me help for my needs once and again. Not that I seek the gift, but I seek the fruit that increases to your credit." Now, do you see that? Paul's saying, when the church invested in the Apostle Paul, and then Paul went out and preached the gospel from town to town and region to region, when Paul would win souls for Christ or to mature churches, the people that invested in the Apostle Paul, it was counted to their credit, for they invested in the thing that continued the kingdom of God. So Paul's saying, it's not that I needed the money. If you were to read earlier in Philippians chapter 4 and later in Philippians 4, you begin to see that he talks about all that I need, thy hand is provided. Everything that Paul wasn't trying to gain wealth, he was saying, it's not that I need your blessing and your finances. It's that when you bless this ministry that I am pursuing and those are being saved by the work of what Paul was doing, it counted to the investor's benefit. So now we go back to verse 9 of Luke 16. As we invest in the kingdom of God, and God begins to move, and we are a blessing to that movement, it counts as credit to us. That's why he says, look, the ways of the world, they are working hard, and they're being very shrewd to invest and to save and to do whatever they can. Why aren't we doing that? Why aren't we pouring our energy and our resources into the things of God to ensure that the gospel goes out and we mature as Christians? Now are you beginning to see why he's saying, it's not that I commended the dishonest manager. I'm commending the fact that, do you see how wise he was, how quickly he had to come up with a plan to make sure his future was safe? Are we doing anything to make sure that our future is sound at all? Or have we become very lazy? I want to show you what this laziness looks like, because Jesus made quite the point about this idea of laziness in Christianity. Luke 12, beginning on verse 19, talked about this particular farmer who had an incredible year where there was so much return from his fields that he just decided, you know, I'm going to build more barns to hold all my wealth and I'm going to sit back and relax. This is what happens. Verse 19 of Luke 12, it says, "And I will say to my soul, soul, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Relax, eat, drink, be merry." But God said to him, "Fool, this night your soul is required of you, and the things you have prepared, whose will they be? So is the one who lays up treasure for himself and is not rich towards God." When you and I read this, would we say that we are rich towards God? Are we wise to invest in the things of God? Or are we lazy, selfish Christians? Do you see how harsh this first parable is? When we truly understand that we are to take what we have been blessed with and we are to pour it back into the things of God. We're not to sit back and be lazy and rely on the wealth that somehow we feel we have earned. We should be diligently wise and prudent and rich towards the things of God. Invest in kingdom enterprises. That's what we're thinking towards. We're pouring into the things of God. So when this life is over, look at what we've invested into. Look at what you've invested into something eternal. There isn't a stock on the planet that can guarantee you eternal revenue. Nothing can you invest in that is more sure and more solid than the kingdom of God. Now, here's the issue. Often we might say, look, if I had more, I would invest more. But I don't have a lot. I don't have enough to invest in the kingdom of God. And if I had more, I would give more. There's an issue with that. It's not true. If you had more, you would not invest more. And it's not my opinion. That's what Jesus said. If you go to the next verse in Luke 16, verse 10, he said, "One who is faithful in a very little is also faithful in much. And the one who is dishonest in a very little is also dishonest in much." If you're not investing in the things of God where you are now, if you were to come into an abundance of wealth, you still would not be a blessing. You would still not invest because what you do now is who you are. So, unfortunately, that eliminates our excuse that you would have and I would have where we say, look, we just don't have enough. I can barely get by with what I have. It eliminates that excuse. Jesus is very harsh when he said, look, if you're not investing in my kingdom now, if you had an abundance, you would not be a different person. All it does is amplify your character so that it's visible. Let me show you some scriptures that'll help us bring this to light. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 6 says, the point is this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. Whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. We invest in the kingdom of God because we are becoming prudent and wise for the kingdom of God. We're following a bad example, which is the dishonest manager who did everything he could to ensure his future. And we're learning a good principle from a bad example. The good principle is, are we being wise to do everything in our power to invest in the kingdom of God? And if we sow bountifully into the kingdom of God. We will reap bountifully from the kingdom of God. But notice he said, we're not giving because we've been manipulated or under compulsion. Somebody twisted your arm to do it. You saw something on your television that manipulates you into thinking you can somehow purchase God. You can purchase favor. You can do business with God by giving him some and getting a lot back. That is all inappropriate. No, we invest in what God is doing for an eternal purpose, not to gain wealth here. The whole purpose is not about gaining wealth here, but about securing eternity there. Luke 6:38, he says, Jesus said, give and it will be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over will be put into your lap. For with the measure that you use, it will be measured back to you. Pressed down, shaken together, if you think about that, it's we're making sure as much can possibly fit as possible. It's shaken, it's pressed down so that it's running over. What you give to God, it will be amplified back to you. But it's not, again, so that we gain some earthly wealth and live in lavish anything here. It is for an eternal benefit. Remember, we have to think eternal benefit. The dishonest manager was looking towards his future. His future. That's how we have to remember what Jesus is talking about in this parable. Are we investing in the things of God so that we all would spend time in eternity? Now, Luke 16, verse 11, kind of gives us a little bit of clarity here. It says, if then you have not been faithful in the unrighteous wealth, that's earthly, remember earthly money, who will entrust to you the true riches? That's your heavenly inheritance. And if you have not been faithful in that which is another's, who will give you that which is your own? Now, let's take a look at that a little bit. If we're not faithful with the simple things, like the money that's entrusted to us, you go to work, you have a salary, if you're retired, you have your pension, it goes into your bank, you pay your bills. If you can't be trusted with that, how in the world do you expect God to trust you with a heavenly inheritance? If you can't even handle what's going on here, if you're not faithful to God with your finances on earth, think about what would be trusted of you in eternity. But then he says this, if you have not been faithful in that which is another's. Well, I thought the money here on earth was ours. We worked for it. Isn't it ours? See, now we have to rethink this. In Haggai chapter 2, verse 8, it says that the silver is mine, the gold is mine, declares the Lord of hosts. All good things on this earth are from the Lord. They're his. Remember, Psalm 24, verse 1 says, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. 1 Chronicles 29, verse 12, both riches and honor come from you, and you rule over all. In other words, the money that's in your bank isn't actually yours. It's God, and he's entrusted it to you. What are you doing with it? See, we have this wrong thinking that we worked for it. It's ours for our benefit, for what we want to do, how we want to spend it. It's actually all that we have is God's. And if we think that way, then we are managers of things that are the Lord's. Your home is the Lord's. How do you manage it? Your finances are actually the Lord's. How are you managing them? Your time is the Lord's. How are you managing your time? Does he have any of it? See, it comes all together a different perspective when you actually understand what you've been singing all these years, when you said, I surrender all to thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all. Because what you have has been given to you by God, and you are entrusted with it. So, Now we see, and if you have not been faithful in that which is another's, who will give you that which is your own? When you go and stand before God and you receive your just reward, that will be yours. But you weren't faithful with what he entrusted you here. Do you see how this parable is quite poignant on what we do with the wealth entrusted to us on earth? Are we shrewd with it to invest in our future? Invest in the future of the kingdom of God. And then it says this, verse 13, Luke 16. No servant can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money. Because they're going in two opposite directions. That's why. See, this doesn't talk much about the servant. It talks about the fact that the masters are extremely different. The masters have diametrically opposing demands. Money says get more. God says give more. Money says take care of yourself. God says love your neighbor. We're going in two different directions. So you can't serve money, meaning you're slaving away to get more and more. You can't serve that and serve God, who says to love your neighbor as yourself and to be a blessing and to take care of those around you and to invest in the kingdom of God. See, we've got it. We can't serve both. Choose you this day whom you will serve. Daniel Forgale wrote it this way. I'm sure you've heard this. Riches I heed not, nor man's empty praise. Thou my inheritance, now and always. Thou and thy only first in my heart. High King of heaven, my treasure thou art. Be thou my vision. See, that's the thinking. It's not that God doesn't want you to have an abundance. It's what you do with the abundance that he is looking into. Are you shrewd? Are you wise? Are you prudent? Are you investing in the things of God? Like the dishonest manager sought after making sure his future was secure, are we being wise into our future, or are we complacent with our finances? Now, verse 14, it says, the Pharisees, who were lovers of money, heard all these things and they ridiculed him. Now, if you go back to the beginning of Luke 16, it said he was talking to his disciples, but clearly loud enough so that the Pharisees, who he has been talking with in the previous chapters, could hear what he was teaching. And they are lovers of money. They love the high places at parties. They love walking around in their fancy robes. They love the prestige, and they are lovers of finances and all the stuff that comes with it. And so they hear that parable, and this word ridicule in the Greek is where we get the idea that they look down their noses at him. This idea, like, you know, nose up, snotty. What a foolish thing to say. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 9 says this, but those who desire to be rich fall into temptation, into a snare, into many senseless and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction, for the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. It is through this craving that some have wandered away from the faith and pierced themselves with many pangs. It is not money that is evil. It is the love of money, the pursuit, the passion. That's why you can't serve that and God. Only one has your passion. Only one has your pursuit. So let's make sure we understand, it is not money that is evil. It is the love of money. And the Pharisees were lovers of money. Let's go to verse 15. And he said to them, now we're talking to the Pharisees, Jesus is, You are those who justify yourself before men, but God knows your hearts. For what is exalted among men is an abomination in the sight of God. The law and the prophets were until John, that's John the Baptist. Since then, the good news of the kingdom of God is preached, and everyone forces his way into it. But it is easier for heaven and earth to pass away than for one dot of the law to become void. So we know that the Pharisees have mutilated the law of God, and they've added all their traditions on top of it, making it nearly impossible to even spot the law of God anymore because of the traditions that they have set. And they are trying to please all the men and all the wealthy friends that they have, so they continue to invest in them. And so Jesus says, look, you've disguised the law. You've mutilated it, but it's not going to disappear. Not one dot of the law is going to disappear. And it seems random that he brings this up to them. But he's said this before. He said this on the Sermon on the Mount, actually, in Matthew chapter 5, beginning on verse 17. He said, do not think that I've come to abolish the law or the prophets. I've not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. For truly I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not an iota, not a dot will pass from the law until it's all accomplished. Therefore, whoever relaxes one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. And that's exactly what the Pharisees did. They took the law and they changed it and made themselves filthy rich and put a burden on everyone else, that there was a taxation on them and they had to constantly give money and they would rip people off in the temples, and they made themselves these hierarchy instead of serving the widows and the orphan. That's why we see Jesus say in Matthew 15, verse 8 and 9, these people just honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching as doctrines the commandments of men. The Pharisees have left the law of God, and they're teaching all their commandments, and they've made themselves wealthy, and not wealthy to invest in the things and take care of those around and to invest in the kingdom of God, but just for their own selfish wants. Now, let's pause for a second. Do you see that happening today? Can you see how there are those that claim to be Christians and they tell you to invest in their ministry, but instead of being a blessing and having that ministry pour out, it only makes that person more wealthy? And they'll say they need more things. They need maybe a fancy jet to fly around the world, and they need fancier things, fancier whatever it is. It's all earthly. And then they begin to tell you that you will be favored of God and you should have wealthy things and you should live a wealthy life and maybe you should have a jet too. And it's all circumstantial filth. And we're focused on the wrong thing. We're not focused on eternal things. And this is what the Pharisees had done. They'd made themselves wealthy. And they began to teach commands that they made, and not the commands of God. So Jesus gives an example of a command that they had mutilated. And that's why he brings up this idea of divorce and remarriage. I know it seems like it's out of place, but it actually isn't. What he's doing is he's showing them the very foundational pieces. Now, we know that in Genesis chapter 2, God said, I created men and male and female. They'll leave the father and be united to one another. We know that the covenant of marriage was God's preordained idea for how we are to exist. However, they had mutilated this idea of marriage. And I want to show you that. Let's go to Luke 16. Let's look at verse 18. Here's Jesus giving them an example how they changed the law and made themselves wealthy by it. Here we go. Everyone who divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery, and he who marries a woman divorced from her husband commits adultery. Now, that might seem kind of like a random example, but the idea is, it's the example of how they changed the law. Here's the law. Deuteronomy 24, verse 1 says, "When a man takes a wife and marries her, if then she finds no favor in his eyes because he has found some indecency in her, and he writes her a certificate of divorce and puts it in her hand and sends her out of his house." That's the law that God gave Moses for the people. Now, Jesus was asked specifically about this in Matthew chapter 19. They said, the Pharisees, "Why then did Moses command one to give a certificate of divorce and send her away?" Jesus very clearly said, "It's because of your hardness of heart that Moses allowed you to divorce your wives, and from the beginning it was not so. And I say to you, whoever divorces his wife except for sexual immorality and marries another commits adultery." Jesus was asked point blank about Deuteronomy. What is the law? He said, "Look, you are allowed to get a divorce because you are wicked people. And because you're wicked people, there were marriages that were being abused. And because they were being abused, we needed to make room for there to be a separation to save the people." And that's what Jesus said. However, there were two rabbis that were specialists in this idea of interpreting the law of marriage. One was Shammai and one was Hillel. These are two different rabbinical interpreters of divorce. In other words, they were specialists, Jewish specialists in studying the ancient law. Shammai had a very conservative view of how to read Deuteronomy 24. Because if you were to look at Deuteronomy 24, there's only one word that needs to be interpreted. And I'll show you what it is. Deuteronomy 24 says, "When a man takes a wife, marries her, if she finds no favor in his eyes because he has found some indecency in her." Indecency is the word that needed to be interpreted. What is indecency? So Shammai, the rabbi, said, "It's sexual immorality. If she is unfaithful, then we need to be able to have a certificate of divorce." But Hillel, he said, "Anything. If she overcooks dinner, you can give her a certificate of divorce. If she does anything that disapproves the husband." And so it began to destroy the Mosaic law of God. So now let's go back and see Jesus talking about wealth and investing not in yourself, but investing in the things of God. The Pharisees look down their nose at him and call him ridiculous. And so Jesus calls him out and says, "Look, you're not doing what the law says to do. You've changed the law. You've manipulated the law. And here's an example. I told you that marriage was between a man and a woman. I told you that the only time they should be divorced is for this reason. And you manipulated that. And even the Pharisees had manipulated that. So the Pharisees could gain wealth by marriage and they could gain wealth by divorce because people would pay them off to do these things and they were gaining money. And by the way, this didn't stop with just the Pharisees, but it's gone on for the last 2,000 years because they twisted and changed the law of God." So then Jesus jumps in to this next story, which we see entitled "The Rich Man and Lazarus." This again is speaking to the Pharisees because he's speaking directly to the Pharisees. He's just told them that they've been mutilating the law of God. They're not keeping the law of God. They're being dishonest. They're being hypocrites. And then he tells this story about a rich man and Lazarus. The question is, and the debate has been, is this a parable or did this actually happen? We believe it to be a parable because it's in the sequence of parables, multiple parables, one after another. The only reason why we think that it might be different than a parable is we have a name. All the other parables have this ambiguity. We don't have any names of anybody. It was a prodigal son or the a sower who sowed seed, or a father, or a rich man, or a poor man. Here we actually have a name. We have the name Lazarus. We're going to see why we have the name Lazarus. There are actually three names in this parable. We have Lazarus, Moses, and Abraham. But it still is Jesus getting a point across through this story. Let's take a look at the story. Verse 19. There was a rich man who was clothed in purple and fine linens and who feasted sumptuously every day. So let's get that picture just real briefly. There are actually two different dyes for purples. One was very inexpensive. That's the one that Lydia sold, or if you remember Lydia selling the color purple. That's dyed from beets, the vegetable. But what they're referring to here, because it says fine linen, actually this purple came from a specific seashell, and it took over 1,000 shells to create just one garment in this royal purple color. So this is extreme wealth, extreme extravagance in his clothing. But then it says that he feasted sumptuously every day. These are banquets. This is lining the table with everything that you can imagine, banquet. So Jesus is picturing this and painting a picture for you and I to say this man was just massive, massive exuberance of wealth. The finest and most expensive clothes and the largest food. So much so that they would gather up the food after the banquet and have piles of it left over. That's just the wealth that Jesus is painting for us. Let's go to verse 20. And at his gate, now that word gate symbolizes the idea that this man, this rich man, was in the mansion. It was massive if it has this gate. Was laid a poor man named Lazarus, covered with sores, and desired to be fed with what fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, even the dogs came and licked his sores. So let's paint this picture together. Very wealthy man, elaborately dressed, eating banquets all the time. Extremely poor man named Lazarus, sitting at his gate, hoping to get the food that he doesn't eat up at the mansion. And he has these horrible sores. Even the dogs, the street dogs, are licking his sores. Let me give you a little bit of picture of what that is. First off, the food that fell from this rich man's table, he did not go up there and eat from the floor. This would have been gathered together, brought down to the street corner, and dumped in a pile. We would think of it as the dumpster. It was brought out into the dumpster. Lazarus is eating out of the dumpster what the rich man in the mansion did not eat, just the scraps of his leftover. That's why the dogs are also there. The dogs are digging through, and they're also eating whatever they can find from this dumpster pile. Something else to make note of is the fact that he had sores, many sores, which means, remember, Jesus is talking to the Pharisees. And the Pharisees would have thought that the sores meant that he was ceremonially unclean. These sores, you can't even be part of the worship service with all these sores. So this also makes, not only is he poor, which the Pharisees thought that poverty meant that God wasn't in favor and wealth meant that he was in favor, and Jesus is destroying that image right now. But the dogs are there. Well, this man has open wounds. So the Pharisees are disgusted by this story that Jesus is telling until, notice Jesus calls the rich man a rich man, but he calls this poor beggar on the street Lazarus, because the name means something. Lazarus means the Lord is my helper. That's why, yes, it is a parable, but we have a name. Because the name speaks to this poor man's character, that God is Lazarus's helper. God is for Lazarus. He's watching over him, even though he has to eat out of the dumpster. This is why if we don't use the definition of the name, we could misinterpret that rich people go to hell and poor people go to heaven. Because that's what happens here next. If you go to verse 22, the poor man died and was carried by the angels to Abraham's side. And the rich man also died and was buried. And in Hades, being in torment, he lifted up his eyes and saw Abraham far off and Lazarus by his side. So we see that the wealthy man died, went to hell. And we see that Lazarus, the poor man, died and he went up to heaven. And if we don't understand what's going on, we think that if you're poor, you go to heaven. If you're rich, you go to hell. And that's not true. Let's make sure we get the full grasp of this story so we don't misinterpret what Scripture says. Number one, let's look at verse 22. The poor man died and was carried by angels. Notice no mention of a burial. He is so poor that he cannot afford a burial. There is no service for him. He is taken to Abraham's side. Now, in some translations, it says Abraham's bosom. Abraham's bosom, the idea of a bosom is it refers to a banquet where you would sit next to someone. You are near my bosom. That's what that actually refers to. So this banquet that this poor man watched the rich man eat has now been reversed. Now the wealthy man is in hell looking at Lazarus, the poor man, sitting next to Abraham at the banquet in heaven. He's sitting next to Abraham. So calling it Abraham's side is fine, but it means at a banqueting table right next. Let's go back to verse 22 and notice it says, the rich man also died and was buried. He had a huge funeral. He's rich. Of course he had a big funeral. He has a big obelisk for a grave. He is well known. Well, everybody was there at his service. Poor man was carried by angels, but no one on earth knew. You can see how Jesus is helping the Pharisees understand that what men see is not the priority, it's what God sees is the priority. Can you see that? By the way, in verse 23, it says in Hades. That is just the Greek equivalent to the Hebrew word Sheol in the Old Testament. When you see, I've gone down to Sheol, down to hell. This is the Greek equivalent in Hades, down to hell. Now, let's go to verse 24 and see what this rich man does. It says, and he called out, Father Abraham. This is the rich man in hell looking up and saying, Father Abraham. Notice that he called him Father Abraham, which means he would be Jewish. Now, we're talking to Pharisees. Pharisees would have never thought a Jew would go to hell. So now we're dumbfounded. The Pharisees are completely overwhelmed. A poor beggar is next to Abraham. And the rich man, who's a Jewish man, he is in hell, but he knows who Father Abraham is. He believes in Father Abraham. That's very eye-opening if we're paying attention. Have mercy on me, he said, and send Lazarus to dip the end of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am in anguish in this flame. But Abraham said, child, remember that you in your lifetime received your good things and Lazarus in like manner bad things, but now he is comforted here and you are in anguish there. Now, again, we could misinterpret this by thinking that if we have wealth here on earth, we're going to be in hell, and if we're poor here on earth, we'll be in heaven. And that's not true. And here's one quick example. Abraham, Father Abraham, the one that this bosom where Lazarus supposedly is next to, Abraham was immeasurably wealthy. His wealth was vast. He had his own private army. He did business with kings. He was immeasurably wealthy. But it's also what Abraham did with his wealth. It was the condition of his heart that God was looking at, and Abraham was faithful and a friend to God. This rich man only just lavished on himself, pleasured himself, took care of himself. Do you see how this, it's not that it's the wealth, Wealth is not the indicator. It's the use of wealth that clarifies the heart's intention. And that's what we want to make sure we understand here. See, remember in Luke 16:14, it says the Pharisees were lovers of money. And that's why they are so consumed by what's going on. Now, let's go down to verse 26. And besides all this, between us, this is now Abraham speaking to the rich man who is in hell. Besides all this, between us and you, a great chasm has been fixed, in order that those who would pass from here to you may not be able, and none may cross from there to us. In other words, once you have made that decision, once it's over, it's over. You can't pay your time, pay your dues in hell and arrive in heaven. You see how that helps us understand that that is not possible. So verse 27, he said, then I beg you, Father, to send him to my father's house. That is, would you send Zechariah or to my father's house? For I have five brothers, so that he may warn them, lest they also come into this place of torment. But Abraham said, they have Moses and the prophets, let them hear them. And he said, no, Father Abraham, but if someone goes to them from the dead, they will repent. He said to him, if they do not hear Moses and the prophets, neither will they be convinced if someone should rise from the dead. Now let's wait just a second. That was quite a mouthful. The rich man says, can Lazarus come give me relief? Abraham says, absolutely not. Heaven cannot touch hell. Hell can never approach heaven. Two opposing masters. Are we seeing the connection now? Two opposing paths. You cannot serve the two masters. They are a chasm away from each other. So the rich man says, okay, can you send Lazarus to go back to my brothers and tell them that heaven is real and hell is real and that they need to stop living selfishly and invest in the kingdom of God? And he says, no, because they already have all that they need to know that. And he said, no, that's not true. If they could just see Lazarus, who was dead, come back to life, man, they would believe it. And he says, if they don't believe what Moses has already written, which is the Old Testament, the written word of God, nothing will convince them. And here's kind of the clincher for you and I. Another man named Lazarus did rise from the dead, and the Pharisees did not change their mind. Jesus died and rose from the dead, and the Pharisees did not change their mind. Because basing our relationship on whether we believe and invest in God on miracles has never, ever worked. It's scripture alone. We must use scripture alone. Sola scriptura. It is the Latin phrase that they used for the entire Reformation. They would chant sola scriptura, which means scripture alone. This is what we use to decide in our own heart what we invest in. Are you going to invest in the things of God for your future, or are you going to live for your own selfish gain? We don't need to see angels. We don't need to see the dead rise. We don't need to have constant signs and wonders and somehow continue to be entertained. And if we're entertained enough and we have enough emotional stimulus, then we'll serve God with our wealth and serve God with our passion. That's what the church has fallen into. That's the trap we're still in. We need constant stimulus to keep us following God. And he says, no, I have given you all that you need. See, now it's not random. When we look back and we see Jesus say, it's easier for heaven and earth to pass away than for one dot of the law to become void. Because in John 5:39, he said, when you search the scriptures because you think that in them you'll have eternal life, and it is they that bear witness about me. The scriptures lead to Jesus. and the Pharisees missed it. The Pharisees were supposed to study the scriptures, and they should have seen that they all point to Jesus. You and I need only the scriptures, and then we invest in the things of God. Let me show you this before we close. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 14. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and have firmly believed, knowing from whom you have learned it. And how from childhood you have been acquainted with the sacred writings, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. All that we need, his hand has provided. It is sola scriptura, scripture alone. We do not base our investment in eternity on miracles only. It is through the written word of God and a commitment to invest in the things that God shows us to invest in. Father, help us to invest in our eternity. We have become very selfish. We invest in us and our pleasure. And we think that if we had more, then we would invest into the things that are of your pleasure. But we have seen that you told us that that's not true. Our character is our character. So we make the hard prayer that says, change our heart, O God, that we would be wise and prudent to invest into you, our time, our energy. We would dive into the pages of Scripture, not worried about satisfying our emotional high, but being acquainted with sacred writing. And in the sacred writing, we would find all that we need for life and godliness. Father, we close this time receiving our correction by praying back to you the very prayer that you taught us. We all pray together as our confession. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. God bless you all until we meet again.